His presence, and I knew this was a place where love abides. For this is a temple, Jehovah God abides here. For we are standing in His presence on holy ground. We are standing on holy ground. And I know that there are on holy ground. In His presence there is joy beyond all measure.
We are going to praise the Lord at this time with our tithes and our offerings. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18 says, "But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is He that giveth thee power to get wealth." whatever our achievements might be in life, it is not because of our hard work, nor because of our talent or our wisdom, but it is only because God has blessed us. This morning I told you that God has given us two hands. And I believe that one hand is to give and one hand is to receive. I'm going to ask you at this time to put your receiving hand aside and take your giving hand and just give and give and give. And whatever you give comes right back to you. Deacons, please come forward, ushers. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we praise your name again, because indeed you are the great giver. You have opened your arms wide and you have given us all things freely so that we can enjoy the blessings of life. Lord, you have not blessed us for us to only enjoy ourselves, but you have blessed us so that we might bless others. As we give of your own to you at this time, we ask that you will bless the gifts and bless the givers. And above all, may we give ourselves to you so that you can use us for your honor and for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name.
Sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer out to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy. We bring sacrifice of praise into the of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you the sacrifice of joy. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer to you. The sacrifice is of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you. The sacrifice is of joy, and we offer up to you. The sacrifice is of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you. The sacrifice is of joy. The sacrifice is of joy. The sacrifice is of joy.
It's scripture reading time, but before we do the scripture reading, I have a Bible to give to a family to keep for a week. It's kind of heavy, so we're going to look for someone strong, or maybe a few people to carry it. Well, I had it for a week, and one of the texts that I reflect on for this week was Psalms chapter 46, verse 1. It said, God is our refuge and strength, a very what? Present help in time of trouble. The word of God is so sweet, I'm telling you, brethren. This was written so many years ago, and it's still a present help in trouble. And boy, as people who don't like to do the right thing, we are always in trouble. So we're going to need God all the time. Amen? Very present help. So I'm going to present this to our family. Brother Andrews.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Yes, I was thinking about it. I pray. I said, Lord, you got to give me somebody who I need to present this to. And Brother Andrews, since Brother Andrews came on board, he needs some help. Amen? He's been driving the van, lifting, he's doing everything. And his supporter, who's supposed to support him, sometimes just keep telling him, go ahead and do it. Go ahead and do it. But I don't see her lifting anything. So, yes, we presented to her. So you guys just spend some time on this week. Maybe you can zero in on one text or something and see if you can find some help in trouble. Amen? Amen. Laura, I didn't recognize you this morning. You took a haircut. Okay, so we're going to proceed with our scripture reading. Shall we all stand, please? You know, when you stand, you get a little... Let the blood flow. Okay, the scripture reading is taken from Luke chapter 18, and we'll go from verses 1 to 8. I would read the first verse, and then you would read the second. But this is how I want you to read. I want you to read very slowly, and read like you know how to read, amen? So that we would understand what we are reading, amen? Okay, so I will begin, and you would get an idea of what I want from you. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, avenge me of mine adversary. Yet Because this widow troubled me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them together? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith in the earth? Amen. This is the reading of the Lord. You shall be seated. We heard the voice of our own Sister Alcock a little while ago. Amen? And she was telling us that this is a holy place where we are. And so we are going to hear her voice again. So I want you to say a little word in your heart for her, that exactly what she would like to bring out in the words of this song, that you are going to get exactly that. Amen? However, after she sings, then we're going to have our own Pastor Alcock present the word of truth to us. Praise the Lord.
Debtors.
deliver us from evil.
Happy Sabbath, church.
Happy Sabbath.
God is good. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I need you to pray a little extra for me today. I have a challenge for me. I intend to talk with us today. So I'm going to ask you to pray for me and also not to sleep. Amen. God gives different gifts. And some are preachers and some are teachers. And so I'm going to praise God. And some are singers. God knew my limitation. And as a result, he blessed me with one who could sing. Amen. 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 So I want to thank God for Sister Alcock and her ministry. Amen.
Amen.
May God continue to bless you as you serve God wherever you are. I want to just welcome everybody into the house of God today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. May God continue to bless you as we worship him in spirit and in truth. Sister Maynard, children and sister and children, we want to welcome you into the family fellowship of East New York today. Amen.
Amen.
Let us continue to pray for each of us. I want to remind us that in your calendar of events, the inner inside of the back page is that Bible reading for the year. Elder Mirage spoke about it earlier, and so we're going to try to keep reading the Bible this year. The Bible says that we can survive on every word that proceeds from God's mouth. Amen? Amen. My time is far spent, or the time is far spent, and as a result, they expect me, all those who went before me, expect me to speak for 14 minutes. And so, if I go beyond, it means I didn't meet their expectation. Amen. Pray with me. Father, we come before you today. We ask God that you will speak to us even now. Hide me in the shadow of your cross and pray, God, that we will hear Jesus and we will see him lifted up. Draw us closer to you, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture today for our sermon exercise comes to us from 2 Kings. We have just read in Luke chapter 8, but turn your Bibles with me to 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. When you're there, say amen. Whether it's the printed or electronic page, 2 Kings chapter 4. I want to publicly say happy Sabbath to Sister White. I needed to do that publicly on camera. I had a conversation with Sister White this week, and she said, Pastor, I have church on my floor every Sabbath. Amen. Amen. And she's looking forward to coming back and worshiping with us. Let's continue to pray for her. Amen. 2 Kings, the fourth chapter. The word of God comes, the King James Version has it recorded this way. And there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, Thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondmen. And Elijah said unto her, What shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, Thine handmaid had not anything in the house save a pot of oil. Then he said, Go, borrow thee vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. And when thou art come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shalt pour out into all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full. So she went from him and shut the door upon her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, Bring me yet a vessel. And he said unto her, There is not a vessel more, and the oil stayed. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said unto her, Go, sell the oil, pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children off the rest. No vessel, no oil. No vessel, no oil. A karate teacher, one who teaches karate, was with his student one day, and the student believed that he had advanced to the level of black belt. He had learned everything that there is to know in karate. He thought that he was just there, that he had known as much as his teacher in the art of karate. And he went to his teacher one day and says, I know everything that you know. I think I am ready to just go out and either start my own karate school or take the world on my own. And the only thing that I need you to teach me now is to teach me about God. The karate teacher took his student to the dining table and offered him a cup of tea. And as the student sat at the table, the karate teacher began to pour from his tea container into the cup. And while the cup was full, it continued to flow over the side of the cup into the saucer. Until the saucer was full, it flowed over from the saucer to the table and on the floor. And the student was just amazed. And he began to say to the teacher, Stop, because the cup is full. The teacher looked at the student and said, That is your relationship with God. Here's your problem. You are so full of yourself that there is no space for God. For God to come in, you have to be empty. That's a whole other sermon. Imagine yourself at the end of your rope. Many of us might not be able to understand or even fathom that. But while you and I are sitting here today celebrating the goodness of God and the fact that we ate breakfast this morning and our bills are relatively paid. We are in decent health. And we know that after church, there is lunch downstairs. And we know we're going home after church to a house that is heated with warm with the heat that we have. There are thousands across the United States today who did not get paid yesterday. Imagine you being at the end of your rope. Imagine that you spend the last dime and you sitting at your porch on your step, not knowing where the next dime is coming from. It's hard to fathom. I know it's hard, but try as close as you possibly can. Imagine that you're at a place where you have nothing, literally nothing. I watched the news this week and heard one federal worker, one who worked for the government, says that I am now planning to pawn my possession to feed my children. Because I have two children, one that needs to go to therapy. I hear one worker says that I must now choose between my treatment for my wife who has cancer and paying the bills to keep a roof over my head. Imagine being at the end of your rope. I mean, imagine being at the end of your rope, but being at the end of your rope, living in one of the richest countries on earth. Come with me to 2 Kings. The Bible says that there was this woman. It begins by saying that she's a woman, but it automatically tells us that she's a widow, because she went to the prophet Elisha and says, "Your servant, my husband, is dead." If you look at those days, here's what happened: is that the husband played the role of the head of the house, and as custom would have it, that the wife would stay home and take care of the children. Perhaps pre-adventure, Sister Hines, she was like one of those women described in Proverbs chapter 31, that she would take care of her children and take care of her husband. So when he leave the house, people could know that he came from this home. He was well taken care of. But now her husband was dead, the breadwinner, no more money coming in. And the Bible suggests, if you could look at this, that perhaps her sons were young, too young to go out and work, but now they are forced to grow up and take on adult responsibility. The Bible says she went to the man of God and says, "My husband, your servant, one who has served in your school, the school of the prophet, one who has been faithful to God in his service to God, who had returned a faithful tithe and give a liberal offering, who showed up when the church was open, who helped to drive the van and lift things around here, one who was always busy. Your servant, my husband, is dead. Now, I don't know where the next paycheck is coming from. There are bills that are coming on the 1st or the 15th, and I don't know where that money is coming from. And not just that, my husband, your servant, is dead, but he died leaving us in debt." Let me talk to us quickly. I promise I'm going to talk to us. Men, I want you to hear me good. Fathers, I want you to hear me properly. Being a father is more than making a child. I know. Just don't go to sleep. That's all I'm asking you. It's going to be tough to swallow, but just don't go to sleep. And when you decide to take on that responsibility, you are duty bound to prepare for your children and your family, your spouse. The Bible says that he died leaving his family in debt. Which makes me, as I start to look, there are a lot of different views of that historians put on this text. But it dawned on me that somewhere along the line, something wasn't done right. We live in this country, and if you're in high school or junior high school, now your turn, hear me now. As you enter college, here you're going to find all these money sharks all over after you, trying to offer you credit cards because you are fresh, and they want to help you to understand that if you have this piece of plastic, it's a part of the American dream and you can accomplish anything. Hear me good today, ladies and gentlemen. Hear me good today, young people. My mother taught me something a long time ago. To this day, my mother is in her 80s and she does not own a credit card. And I mean, here's what she taught me. She says that if you can't afford it, you can't afford it. But this plastic given to us by creditors sometimes causes us to pretend to behave as if we can afford things that we cannot afford. I promise, if you don't go to sleep, I'll preach 5 minutes before I sit down. But stay with me. Stay with me. Now, not all debts are bad. Can I teach in here for one quick minute? There is good debt and there is bad debt. Good debt is anything that you have where after purchasing it, it appreciates. The value appreciates. So having mortgage is a good debt. Are you with me? I mean, if you have to, you don't have to take out loan for your first college degree in America. Hello? But if you have to take out loan for your education, that's a good debt. On the flip side, there's bad debt. If in an effort to keep up with the Joneses, you find yourself in a car parking. And can I just tell you something quickly? That it doesn't matter how expensive your car is. You may pay $65,000 for that new Mercedes Benz, but I promise you that if you drive it off the block, go around the block, come back to the same dealer, you will never get the same amount of money for it, because the moment you drive it off the block, it depreciates. That is bad debt. And I'm not saying you are not to have things that are valuable and expensive, because God expects us to be the head and not the tail. All I'm saying is that when we look at debt, we ought to make sure that we are balancing, that we are doing stuff, that we are living within our means. America promised us, watch this now, America promised us the pursuit of happiness. You never read, you misunderstood that. You thought that America was going to give you happiness. It promises the pursuit of happiness. And many of us spend our life pursuing this happiness to our own detriment, where we are spending what we don't have. And in the black community in America, while we collect a small percentage of the income, or we own a small percentage of the wealth in America, we spend more than everybody else. Because for some strange reason, we believe that we need to maintain a particular look. And as a result, there are many of us who we just live from paycheck to paycheck. Now, don't get me wrong. God knows there are some of us who can't do better, like the preacher. But for those of us who can, you ought to make plans. And the moment you become a parent, hear me, parent. The moment you become a parent, you gotta change your views, because now you are not just taking care of yourself. You have to make plans for your children. Don't wait until they graduate high school to start put something aside for their college. Ouch. You ought to make plans for tomorrow. While we're living in the last days, and we know that God is coming soon, he does say that we are to occupy until he comes. Hello? While Jesus is our assurance, we need to make sure we have some insurance. Let me get back to God's word. I know you ain't gonna like that. But there's no need for us to walk around having a store card in every store just to say our wallet and our purses are filled with credit cards and that we can afford this. Let me tell you something. The reason why we ought to walk with a credit card or a debit card, preferably a credit card, is not so that we can overspend, but it's simply that we have access to cash without walking with cash. And so the moment you acquire it on your credit card, you need to know how you're going to pay for it. Let me get back to the word. The word says that he died leaving his family in debt. The strain of his lifestyle was now being carried on the shoulder of his wife and children. Not only did they have to grieve his passing, not only were they worried about burying him, but now they are not just worrying about how do they eat after his funeral, but now they have to worry about paying his debt after they have buried him. Watch this. Not only was she worried about that, but that the creditor was now calling on her for somebody else's debt. Can I just put one more nugget in this before I continue? Parents, when you start to have money talk, involve your children.
Amen.
Don't hide it from them. Because when you involve them, they might better understand when you say we don't have it. You have to teach them from their small the value of things. You can teach them that there's value in a $350 pair of sneakers, or you can teach them that there is value in their education. Because if they wear the $250 pair of sneakers, they may lose their life for it on the block. But if they get educated, they can own the company that make the sneakers. Somebody say amen up in here. And for that reason, they grow up becoming athletes and becoming musicians and becoming great people. But they have no money management skill. And so they get it easy and it goes easy. Our responsibility is to teach them that the value of things are not as important as the value of who they are. And so here's what happened. When she discovered that the creditors are coming, she began to get letters with red windows. She began to get call after call after call that her credit was now in the dump. And she was now being called by creditor after creditor. And she realized that she had nowhere to turn to. She went to church. My mentor told me, one of my mentors said you should only preach one sermon at a time, so let me stay with this one. She went to church to seek the man of God, and when she got there, she says to him, My husband, your servant, he has been faithful in service to church, and he's dead, and he has left a huge debt behind, and my children, my two boys, are now on the chopping block. They are about to be captured and used as slaves because it's the only way the debt can be paid. And the Bible says, watch this, the Bible says that the man of God asked her two questions. And before she could answer the first one, she asked him a second one. The first question is, what can I do for you? Statistics tells us that in America, most people in America wait until a year before they seek help in terms of repairing their credit. They're too ashamed, they're embarrassed, and they wait almost a year before they seek help. Can I share with you today that when you are in trouble, Elder Gilbert just said it, Psalm 46, verse 1, that our God is our refuge and strength. When trouble shows up, you don't need to wait 12 months. You don't need to wait 6 months. As a matter of fact, you can call on him because he's a very present help in time of trouble. The Bible says that before you call, he will answer. And while you are praying, help is on the way. So when you get in trouble, just call on Jesus. I know you ask, why Jesus? Well, let me tell you, sometime you will call church folks and church folks will be busy. But my God is always there. And he's always there to help. Here is what the word says, that you can always trust God because God will always make a way. God cares about you. Songwriter says, does Jesus care? Yes, he cares. Oh, yes, he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. Let's go to God's word, Psalm chapter 50 and verse 15. Here is what the word says. Here's what God's word says. So you could understand that God cares. The Bible says, call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will do what? There are two parts to it. I will deliver thee, and after God delivers you, your responsibility is to give him some glory. Is there anybody in here who has ever been in a bind and God delivered you? You've been between a rock and a hard place, but God showed up and he made a way out of nowhere. Our God is saying that when I deliver you from your mess, your responsibility is to give me some glory. God cares about us. He will always make a way for us. Psalm 147, verse 4, the word of God tells us. He says that God says that he counts the stars. This is the God that I serve. God doesn't just care about us, but he says he numbers the stars and he calls them by name. If God knows the name of the stars that show up, can I tell you something? He also says that he called me by my name and I am his. You can trust God even when trouble shows up. Psalm 50 verse 11, one more text. Here's what the word says. Psalm 50 verse 11, God says, I know every bird on the mountaintop. Hello, somebody. He says, I know every bird on the mountaintop, and everything that moves in the field is mine. God can take care of you. Can I share one more with you? Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 26. Here's what God says. God says, look at the birds of the air. Huh? Look, that they do not sow, do they, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Watch this now. God then asks us a question that God wants us to think about who we are. God says, are you not better than the birds of the air? Here's what the word continues to say. He says, which of you can by taking thought can add one cubit to your stature? Which of you can make yourself grow? Or not just add one thing to your stature. And why take ye thought of your raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, the word says, how they grow. They don't toil, neither do they spin. Continue. Here's what the next verse says. And yet I say unto you that not even Solomon, the richest man who ever lived, in all of his glory, not some, but in all of his glory, was not arrayed like any of these lilies. Watch what God says in verse 30. Wherefore, if God can clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast even in the oven, shall he not also clothe you, O ye of little faith? What I'm trying to say to you today, if God can cover the earth with green grass, if God can allow snow to fall and the sun to shine, if God can feed the animals in the forest, then God will take care of you. You're not listening to me today. Can I tell you something? This is going to blow your mind. Can I tell you something? This is going to blow your mind. Do you think that the rats in New York City worry about their breakfast when they get up in the morning? I was thinking about it, and it cracked me up that the rats,
The rats in New York City, they don't worry about where the next meal is coming from. Hello? But can I tell you how God works? But that God will find somebody, although it's not good to litter, God will have somebody leave something on the sidewalk weeks in advance or days in advance, that God will allow it to stay there, and the sun will burn it and the rain will wash it from your block to the next block, because God knew that somewhere coming up the other block there was a rat that was traveling up the street that needed something to eat, and God will allow the rat to meet his meal at the right time. If God will take care of a New York City rat, I know God will take care of me. I am more valuable to God than than these New York City rats. So God will always make a way. The man of God says to her, what is it that you want me to do for you? What is it that you have in your house? Hold up. I just came to you and said, I don't have anything. The woman said, sir, as the Lord liveth, I don't have anything in my house except a pot of oil. That's all I have, a pot of oil. That's all I have, a pot of oil. But can I tell you that what you already have is enough for God to work with? You're not listening to me. You don't have to be envious of anybody else. You don't have to try to keep up with the Joneses, because what you have is enough for God to work with. Yes, Sister Henry, little is much when God is in it. If you give what you have to God, God will multiply it. It may not be much, but God can use it. If all you have is a handful of meal at the bottom of the barrel, God will stretch it to feed Elijah, and God will stretch it to feed your son and you until the famine passes. If all you have is 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, if you give it to God, God will stretch it to feed a multitude and have leftovers to feed his disciples. If all you have is a stick in your hand, if you give God the stick, he will use the stick to bring trouble on Egypt. He will use the stick to part the Red Sea. If all you have is a rod in your hand, God will use it to lead his children to freedom. If all you have is the jawbone of an ass, God will use it to destroy your enemies. Give God what you have, and God will use what you have to accomplish his desires in you, for you, and through you. The Bible says, she said, all I have is a pot of oil. Can I just share this with you? That whenever you think that you don't have anything, before you start complaining, there is somebody is dreaming for what you have. Never compare yourself to anybody else, because there's always somebody in a better position and somebody in a worse position. And so, like Paul, we are to learn how to be content. Isn't that what Paul says? Paul says, in all things, I've been up and I've been down, I've been full and I've been empty, but in all things, I've learned to be content, because God, Paul knows that his God will supply not some, but all his needs according to God's riches in glory. So here's what the man of God says. Okay, you have some oil in your house. Here's what I want you to do. Go borrow pots. I like God, but God sometimes just messes me up. I mean, go borrow pots. Now, if you miss the point, now, here is a woman who is in debt. She's desperate. She comes to the church in East New York for help. And East New York says, what do you have at home? She says, I just got a little oil in the kitchen. And rather than giving her a check, East New York says, go borrow pots. You have to understand the foolishness of the gospel. And so she said, go borrow pots. Yeah, go borrow pots. Go borrow pots. But in the process of borrowing pots, don't borrow just a little bit. Borrow a whole lot. Isn't that where it says? Don't borrow a few. Borrow a whole lot. So see, this lady now, she got herself together. Come on down and she knocks. Sister Roberts, I know you know my husband is dead. Do you have any empty pots I could borrow? How ridiculous is that?
Okay, I thank you for the two. I promise I'll bring them back. And Sister Say, do you have any extra empty pots that I could borrow? I don't know how long, but I'm just borrowing them. If you could lend them to me, I promise I'll bring them back. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sister Say. Can you see her in the community? And somebody's going to say, this woman has lost her natural mind. She her husband is dead and she took it to heart. And now she's just walking all over around crazy. But can I tell you today, brothers and sisters, that what God is looking for in Israel is somebody with some ridiculous faith. Somebody who will trust him when they can't trace him. Somebody will say, if God says it, I'll do it, even when I don't understand it. But if it comes from God, I'm going to follow God, because I may not see the end, but God is the beginning and the end. I may not know how he'll do it, but God will make a way somehow. We got to learn to trust God even when we can't see him. The Bible says she borrowed some pot. Let me hurry up. My time is far spent. But here's what the word says. When she borrowed the pots, she went home. And when she went home, she put the pots in the house. Then she went back. She went back to Elder Henry and said, Elder Henry, I borrowed the pots. Now what? Now she has one pot of oil and a whole room full of pots. Now the math don't add up. Not even Common Core could fix this. And so the man of God says, now here's what you need to do. Go home, you and your sons, close the door behind you. Don't just read words. Close the door behind you and then fill the pots. Now after you fill the empty pots, sell, pay your debt, and live on the profit. Oh, help me, Holy Spirit. Now let me do this and sit down. The Bible says, the man of God says, take the oil and the empty pots and go behind closed doors. Because when God is trying to work, God is not trying to do this so that you could get the accolades. Oh, you're not listening to me today. Sometimes when God is working, we want the praise. We want the glory. But can I tell you that God want to take us into our closet? God want to take us behind closed doors. Watch this. Because when we are not behind closed doors, we are putting on a show. Help me, Holy Spirit. One writer says that if Hollywood should ever run out of actors, all they got to do is to go to church. We know how to put on a face. We know how to put on a show. We know how to impress our neighbors. But can I tell you something? That when you're behind closed doors, you don't impress nobody, because you can't impress God. Behind closed door, God will expose you. And God knows everything about you. And God want to bless you in secret and bless you openly. So the man of God says, take your empty pots and take your oil and go behind closed doors and shut the door and allow God to work in secret. Because when God get ready to elevate you, you ought not to get the glory, but God will always get the glory. And here's what the word says. My time is up. Here's what the word says. That she did what the man of God says. Went behind closed doors, closed the door, and begin to pour. As she began to pour, something miraculous began to happen. Because as she poured and filled one pot, she realized that her pot was still full. Oh my God. As she poured and filled the second pot, she realized that her pot was still full. As she poured and filled the third pot, she realized that her pot. I've come to discover, brothers and sisters, I opened a bank account with God, and God has given me a debit card called PRAYER. I've gone to the bank every day and I've made a withdrawal. I can't understand it, but there's never a debit sign in my account, because the more I draw out is the more God puts in. The more I trust him is the more he blesses me. You can't be God's giving, no matter how hard you try. When you give God what belongs to God, God will bless you beyond your wildest dream. You will never understand it, but if you trust God, God will do it. The Bible says she filled all her pots.
And when she realized that the pot in her hand was still full and the last borrowed pot was full, she said to her son, bring me another pot because I've got extra oil. And the son says, mommy, mommy, there are no more pots. There are no more vessels. Hold up, watch this. And the Bible says that when all the pots were full, the oil stayed. Two quick things. The amount of vessels she borrowed is a reflection on her faith in God. If she had borrowed few vessels, she would have been expecting God to give her a small blessing. But she borrowed many vessels, expecting a big blessing. Watch this. And the Bible says that when the vessels run out, as long as there was an empty vessel, help me, Holy Spirit, the oil kept flowing. As long as there was an empty vessel, the oil kept flowing. But the moment she ran out of vessels, which meant if she had 100 more empty vessels, the oil would have kept flowing. You gotta trust God, because God is bigger than your situation. He's bigger than your bad debt. He's bigger than your bills. He's bigger than your medical experience. God will always go farther. The moment she ran out of vessels, the oil stayed. There was no more need for the oil to flow. So hear me today, church. If you don't have a vessel, there will be no oil. If you don't give God a vessel, there will be no oil. Because the moment the vessels ran out, the oil stayed. And the Bible says that she did what the man of God says. She sold the oil. Watch this. She sold the oil, paid her debt, paid her husband's debt, paid off all her debt. She was now debt free. But watch this, that she had enough to live on for the rest of her life. I got to do a talk about this in Bible class. I can't preach it. But can I tell you something? I heard Steve Harvey said that somebody shared with him one day that if you have one job and it's not cutting it, there's no point having a second and a third job, because a second and a third job isn't going to do what the first job couldn't do. And there are those of us who come to this country and we're working 3-4 jobs, try to make ends meet, and the only time we sleep is when we come to church. But can I hear tell you what he says? His mentor told him. Can I tell you what I say? His mentor told him. He said that if you have a first job and it's not cutting it, the second job won't do it. You need to go and invest and do a business on your own. Don't be comfortable working for the man or the woman. You ought to start envisioning owning the company. Don't be satisfied with being a used car dealer. You ought to envision owning the car parking lot. It's not adequate to work for the company, but as a child of God, you ought to envision and work towards owning the business. I know it's hard to swallow. You can't even say amen. But can I tell you, you got a plan for yourself. You got a plan for the future. The Bible says that she was a good businesswoman. She sold, paid off her debt, and had enough investment to live for the rest of her life. And when she died, her sons were not in debt. Let me close. A little girl went to a supermarket with her mother one day. The supermarket clerk, after the mother paid for the bill, the supermarket clerk looked at the little girl and says, there's a jar of candy. Put your hand in it and take as much as you can. The little girl looked at the candy and looked at her mother. And looked at the candy and looked at her mother. The cashier said, go ahead, take the candy. The little girl looked at the candy and looked at her mother. Looked at the candy and looked at her mother. I said, Mommy, you take the candy. So the mother reached in and took a handful of candy. And as they walked to the car, to the parking lot, the mother says to the little girl, she said you could take it. Why didn't you take the candy? The little girl looked at the mother and says, Mommy, I understood that your hand
is bigger than mine. Somebody listen to me today. Can I share with you? Can I share with you that when your trouble comes, you don't need to take your trouble on. You need to just look to God. You're not listening to me. When trouble shows up on your doorstep, you don't need to fight your trouble. Just look to God. Do what David did. David says in Psalm 121, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? Hold up. My help doesn't come from the mayor's office. My help doesn't come from Albany. My help doesn't come from 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. But my help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Can I tell you something? That's why Paul says that my God shall supply all my needs. Not according to my riches, not according to Chase or Bank of America or Capital One, but according to his riches in glory. Can I tell you about my God? My God, bank account has never gone into an overdraft. He has never filed bankruptcy. There's never been a government shutdown, because my God will give us more than we can handle. The word of God said he'll give it a pressed down, shaken together, and an overflowing blessing. When you trust God with what you have, he will pour himself in you until you begin to overflow and bless everybody around you. So my question today is, what do you have in your house? Don't think about the one you left home, but what do you have in here? What do you have to offer God? What do you have to offer? Oh, it may not look like much in your hands, but if you give it to God, somebody says that a tennis racket in my hand is nothing more than about $30, $45. But if you put it in Venus, in any one of the Williams sisters, it's a championship in the making. A basketball in my hand just means a few bucks, but if you put it in Steph Curry's hand, it's a championship. You're not listening to me. Nails in my hands will just bring pain and suffering, but nails in the Savior's hand will bring salvation to the world. And so I came by here today to tell you, place it in the Master's hand. No matter how small it may be, no matter how insignificant it looks, place it in the Master's hand and watch God move on your behalf in 2019. Is there anybody here today who's going to give it to God? Give him your pain. Give him your suffering. Give it to God. Give him the good things and the bad things. Just give it to God. Give him the dreams you want to accomplish. Give him the co-worker that's getting on your last nerve. Give him the children you're praying for. The unbelieving spouse. Just give it to God and watch God work on your behalf in 2019. Give it to God. If you just want to give it to God and watch God work, why don't you stand with the preacher today? God, we're going to give it to you today. We're not going to take it home with us. We're not going to hold anything back. We're just going to give you everything. And we're going to ask you to deal with it on our behalf. And we promise if you work it out, we'll give you the praise and the glory. Would that be all right? Would that be all right? God, we come before you today. We have messed up so many times, not just with money, God, but we have messed up so many times. Financially, we are in debt. Spiritually, we are bankrupt. But we celebrate the fact that when we run out, we can run to God. And so we come to you today, God, and all we have are empty vessels. We come, God, with empty vessels. Our hearts, our minds, our lives are not open to you for your using. Pour within us, God, faith like a mustard seed. Pour within us, Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God that will guide us into all truth. Pour within us, God, dreams so we can go out and accomplish great things. Pour within us, God, the mind of Christ, that when we leave this place, we will not be the same. Make us more like you. Remind us that we are more than conquerors. And may we know that from this day forward, whatever we ask in your name, we will receive. So fill our cups, Lord. Fill it up until it overflows. And may as it overflow, God, we be willing to bless others. We're going to go ahead and claim the healing, claim the business, claim the A's in school, claim deliverance, claim the victory over the enemy. We are going to go ahead and claim it today. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. If you claim it, go ahead and say amen. If you believe God is working it out, say hallelujah. If you believe God has done it on your behalf, go ahead and say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We give him the vessel so that he can pour oil in our lives. Amen.